Everyone, welcome to the lecture number 8 on day 4, second session of the Fishery Oceanography for Future Professionals course by ITCO Ocean INCOIS. This particular topic is on tuna physiology and related oceanography, and you may find it is a little bit now more complicated than the previous lectures. Since now you have already been introduced to the biogeochemistry and other aspects, it is pertinent that this particular level of understanding you should now develop. That will also be a kind of a highlight for the advanced level of course that in future we will be offering. So if you find yourself comfortable with this level of complex science and discussions, the advanced level course is for you. With that introduction, I will start with the presentation. So the findings from one of the our in-house program, that first I will show, that is related to the satellite telemetry. And yesterday we discussed about satellite telemetry, and question based on the questions I came to know and understood that I need to show some slides and findings related to that, and connect today's lecture with that. So first, this is the how satellite telemetry program in the field it looks like. So yesterday you can see in different pictures, yesterday what we discussed and what you came to know, all those things are coming live on your screen now. So how to take care of the fish after it is getting caught, how to quickly put tag on that, how to release. After that, you take the photographs when fish is underwater, so that you come to know that the fish is healthy, it is going to live, and then it is going to collect the data, very much important for you. After that, so basically this is a collaborative project that INCOIS hosted, and we partnered with other agencies. So this is how data of from a tag or a PSAT, pop-up satellite archival tag, looks like. So here you can read this plot this way, that this green depth records, so that you need to read on the left hand axis. The yellow dots on the other hand are about the temperature, not the sea surface temperature, but the temperature of the water surrounding to the fish which is carrying the tag. So that temperature you need to read here. So for any data point where depth and temperature both are recorded together, for example this isolated data point, if I mention about this, shows a depth record of more than 300 meters, where the corresponding temperature you can see that it is about 15 degrees Celsius or less than that. So this is how just a plotting of one tag time series, a portion of that, it looks like. But individual tag or individual data point may not matter much. That is the reason that you need to do extensive tagging, and you need to collect and compile the data from multiple individuals to understand the fish behavior in a particular basin. That is the reason that this was our study region and scope of our study. So you can see that there are two variants of the tags, and one had a depth and temperature sensor which gave us a lot of depth and temperature data. Another also had light sensor, so which gave us some tracks, and we tagged the fishes on both sides of the Indian Peninsula. So that is in the Arabian Sea Basin as well as in the Bay of Bengal Basin. And the results are compiled in a publication mentioned below. So if you require more information or you don't have the access to the journal website, I can provide the author copy upon request. So about first of the results. So we talked about temperature sensor, that is on the tag. So this is what the combined data from all the fishes that is tagged in the Arabian Sea and all the fishes that was tagged in the Bay of Bengal, it looks like. Below graph is both the data set combined again. So here the data labels for each of the columns are percentage. So if you have, for example, 100% data for Arabian Sea, 50% data, it is pertaining to the data points collected, that is pertaining to the 29 degrees Celsius temperature, and likewise. So you can see that overall, if you see for the whole set of the data in the northern Indian Ocean, 88.5, almost 89% data, that is between 27 degrees Celsius to 30 degrees Celsius. And that is little bit surprising, since when you start a kind of a study which is unique and you are doing it for the first time, you will go through the literature, especially from the other basins, other oceans, when there is no such previous precedent set in the your study region. So in the Pacific and Atlantic Oceans, the reports tell us, or papers report that the tunas, because in this particular experiment we focused only on yellowfin tunas which were adults. So this all data that I am going to show right now, it is all about the adult yellowfin tuna in the northern Indian Ocean. Okay, now that is out of the way. So same, their contemporaries in the Pacific and Atlantic Oceans, that is the adult yellowfin tunas in the Pacific and Atlantic Ocean, the temperature that they have been swimming, that is recorded, it is up to in some cases 17 degrees Celsius also, which is difference of 10 degrees Celsius, and it is very significant. That why the tuna in the northern Indian Ocean, it is not diving to the waters where 17 degrees Celsius waters are there. And I don't say that there were no records at all, but as you can see that even by reaching up to 20 degrees Celsius on the x-axis, hardly less than 1% of the data was there at 20 degrees Celsius or below that. So there were scattered data points, but you cannot say that that is a behavior continuously displayed by the fishes that we tagged. And that is how it is started giving us that something is different about the tunas in this northern Indian Ocean. Another sensor that is on the tag, that is the depth sensor. So here also you can see that the columns are about for each of the 10 meter depth bin, how much percentage of the data falls into that, or in other words, how much time in percentage tuna spent at that 10 meter level bin. And you can also see that, I'm giving example for the Arabian Sea here, some four diamonds are there. That is, at this particular diamond here, you can see that 77 it is written. So that means that for the depth of 80 meter or less, 77% of the data, it is within that. So 80 meter or shallower. Similarly, so those diamonds were decided for each of the basin and Indian Seas combined at the break of 75% data, 90% data, 95% data, and 99% data. So this gives you the idea of this cumulative frequency. So this line is cumulative frequency, again, that you read here on the right hand axis. For the columns, you read the percentage on the left hand axis. So that is, you can see that it does not have any trait or significant behavior that it dives deep, and that was the reason that it did not encounter colder waters than 27 degrees Celsius, as we have seen from the temperature data. So that explains in the part why temperature records less than a certain value was not recorded. But that creates another mystery, why fishes are not diving deep, where in other basins or other oceans it is recorded that the fishes tend to have deep diving behavior for foraging. So the tunas might be spending time, or more time in general, in the shallower depths, but when it goes for the food or forage, it dives that deep. So here that is not seen. So is the is there any reason that it stops the yellowfin tunas to dive deeper in the northern Indian Ocean? to see that, again you can actually do a breakup of this diving behavior by day and night. So you want to see that whether any kind of diurnal behavior is there, because ultimately you need to see the relation with the forage, which might exhibit the diurnal behavior. So as you can see that from the internal clock of the tag, you can see that which are the daytime data points, which are the nighttime data points. So all the data points combined for the Arabian Sea were divided into two parts, day data and night data, similarly for Bay of Bengal. So you can see here that in Arabian Sea there is not huge significantly diurnal variability between day and night, but for Bay of Bengal it is more pronounced. So for daytime, Bay of Bengal, majority of the time it is spent at a little bit deeper, and towards the night time it is shallower, whereas in Arabian Sea it is more spread out. That is what we can understand. So after that, another attempt you would do to correlate with the satellite data. So here you take the movement of the fish and see that, okay, if sea surface temperatures were too high, because many of the studies in the Pacific and Atlantic that tells that tunas tend to live in the waters which are up to 8 degrees Celsius cooler than the sea surface temperature. So you want to see that whether that has any correlation. But it is known for the oceanographers that Arabian Sea and Bay of Bengal are in general warmer in the mixed layer, and that you can see here from the sea surface temperature data as well, that when the ambient temperature surrounding tuna that was recorded between 27 to 30 degrees Celsius in most of the time, for sea surface temperature it is not much different. So there is no taking any message and then replicating for the Indian Ocean if you learn something from Pacific and Atlantic. So one has to start from the scratch to understand their behavior in a different way. Another type of satellite data that you can see is with correlation with the sea surface height anomaly or sea level anomaly. What is its importance? I'll explain in the next slide. But here you can see that the trend in the SLA data, it is more pronounced in typical Gaussian curve in compared to the trend in the sea surface temperature. And the correlation also, it is higher. So here you can see that the fishes tend to swim in the regions where it is neither extreme positive or negative sea level anomaly. And what it does mean in terms of oceanography, that I will explain in the next slide. But fishes tend to spend most of the time in the neutral or nearby sea level regions. So that is neither the pronounced convergence zones or divergence zones. So here, as you can see that quantifying also more than or up to 70% data, it is between plus and minus 6 centimeter of sea level anomaly. I'll come to that explanation a little bit afterwards. So whatever hypothesis or the understanding that we get from the tag data, you can also try to validate whether it is same from the fishing data or not. And that you can see that this is being validated from the fishing. So whether you compare with the sea level anomaly or sea surface temperature, the more like a neutral zone rather than in a center of any types of eddies or convergence or divergence zones. Another example of the feedback is also here. So that also repeats that. So we have been collecting these kind of multiple feedbacks, and we have been seeing this again and again. So we feel confident that this is the proper line of query to be pursued. So here is the explanation or importance of sea level anomaly in terms of what it tells us about the vertical column structure of the ocean water. So where the sea level anomaly is negative and very extreme, it is the core of the all the cyclonic eddies. So cyclonic eddies are also known as cold core eddies. Why cold core eddies? Because due to upwelling, the colder waters, that is blue color, dark blue color ones here below the thermocline, this is thermocline depth, this is colder water, this is warmer water. So when sea level anomaly dips, the colder water comes closer to the surface. So it rather mimics or mirrors or reverses. So wherever there is a negative sea level anomaly, the thermocline is shallower. It comes higher. Reverse in case of convergence when downwelling happens. So this is the trait of anticyclonic eddy, which is also known as warm core eddy, where thermocline deepens. So basically, tuna does not prefer, at least in this region, we learned that, to be in either of these core. It prefers to stay in more like a middle zones, we can say. So this is the relation between sea level anomaly and thermocline. Does it have any other relation with any other trait? So another paper of one of these faculty in this course, Dr. Satyaprakash, his paper, and he was also part of this tuna study. The earlier paper shows that the color, background color here, it is about the temperature. And then these red line and black line are correspondingly thermocline and oxycline. The upper panel is for Arabian Sea. Bay of Bengal, it is all over panel. So you can see that thermocline depth and oxycline depth, it is almost going hand to hand in the Arabian Sea and Bay of Bengal both. So whether it is only because of temperature, now that we know that that is not the reason, because the yellowfin tuna elsewhere, they can sustain the lower temperatures. And by those standards of Atlantic and Pacific, the yellowfin tuna in the Indian Ocean, or at least Northern Indian Ocean, should be diving up to these depths very regularly, which is not happening in data, at least what we have seen. So why that is the reason? So to understand that, first we need to see what was the tuna diving pattern in our study. So here you can see that again I'm showing the same of the scope of this study, set tuna study, and I'm showing these tracks in these circles. So here three fish tracks are there, another three fish are there tracks in the Bay of Bengal, and those diamonds are something else that I will come to detail afterwards. So these are not the, these diamonds are not the tags, orange or yellow. So you can remember this map, and then I'll explain in detail. So first we talk about what happened along the track for tuna. So wherever fishes have been in Arabian Sea, you can see again this is the background as a temperature. And temperature, as you can see, that it is very much on lines of what it is reported earlier in other figure also. Here we have plotted this oxycline depth using sea level anomaly data. Red is the thermocline depth. Again, both goes hand to hand. And the cyan line, it is median diving depth for the tuna for that particular day. So median means the equal data weightage on both the side, shallower and deeper. So you can see that the diving behavior is tend to stay always above the thermocline or the oxycline. Does this repeat same in the Bay of Bengal as well? You can see yes. So that is the first conclusion, that somehow tuna is not diving, and what is the reason for that. To dwell into that, we need to understand more about tuna's life cycle and its evolutionary traits. So tuna has two stages, major two stages. In one, it is more like planktonic stage, so that it there is no energy involvement is there, because when we start talking about oxygen, oxygen is useful for the or required for the metabolism and energy, correct? So in the plankton stage, that is not important. But once tuna grows and it starts feeding on its own, then tuna is also known for very fast speeds underwater, for which only streamlined body is not the criteria that one need to have. The muscle energy or the burst of the energy that happens due to the active metabolism, that is also equally important. For example, a marathon runner will be releasing the energy and burning the energy slowly. But a sprinter like Usain Bolt has to release the energy in one go in a short fraction of time. Tuna is capable of that. For that, it has high metabolic rates as well as its oxygen demands are higher. That's why we need to study more in connection with the oxygen. So for that, we need to first understand the evolution of tuna. So evolution of tuna has been done in a way that the energy reserves are very peculiarly low in compared to its size. Here you can see a schematic where small fish is to larger fish is. It goes hand to hand, that if the body size increases, the reserve capacity for the energy also, it is increasing. But tuna is placed very uniquely that it has a higher body size or larger body size, but smaller relatively reserve energy capacity. So whatever energy is being released, it has to be released from the metabolism, and that requires harnessing the dissolved oxygen in the water and then converting that into energy. So this is the reason for the evolutionary like this trait. You can see that tunas have actually evolved from teleost in this Chromidae family, and that gives you some timeline about late Triassic or Jurassic period. So you can say that tuna started evolving while the dinosaurs were roaming on the land and also in the water, and that's where tuna started evolving. So we know that that time oxygen level in the air, and because of the balance of partial pressure in the ocean water also, dissolved oxygen was low in the air as well as water, and that actually helped tuna to evolve in a way that it can survive at least for the low oxygen waters. And that is the reason we can understand that in Pacific and Atlantic, it can actually rather, you can imagine that it stops its breath and then dive deeper in the low oxygen water where the forage fish is available. Forage fish may not have high metabolic rates since they are not swimming fast. So to stay away from the predators, it swims deeper, and then tuna can actually feed on them, then come back again to the ventilated waters. But that somehow did not work in the favor of the tunas in the northern Indian Ocean. So before coming to again the tunas in the northern Indian Ocean, we see what this evolutionary trait means. So basically tuna is the only fish that shows these endothermic traits like a mammal. So even though being cold-blooded, it shows the characteristics like a warm-blooded creature. So we are not going to go in very much deep details for each of these terms. I'll just explain in brief, because these are basically the topics for the advanced level course. So that will be dwelled into in detail in future. So it has endothermic traits, and to support that, it has a mammal like this concurrent heat exchange. What it does basically is that the blood vessels that is flowing near to the surface of the skin, that is outside of the body, will always be passing the cold blood, and then the core, where the core organs are there, it will maintain the higher temperature. That is the reason that if required, tuna can swim in the colder waters even while maintaining the core body temperature higher. And that is also shown by many of the researchers who have been inserting double tags. One is PSAT, that is staying outside the tuna body. At the same time, another tag that is taking the temperature of the core body, and it is transmitting the data to the PSAT, so that you can come to know that what is the difference between the ambient water temperature and core body temperature. Tuna also has developed the arterial reserves, which along with the larger gills, it helps it in the speed attack, because tuna relies on the speed to feed on the fish. So it prefers to be in the clear waters where the forage fish will see it coming. Still, it will always outrun them because of its speed. So that these are the evolutionary traits for tuna. And researchers have been also trying to understand what it means for tuna to stay in the low oxygen waters. So some studies, like one shown here, what they do is that they have created tanks, and tuna is swimming virtually but still staying steadily. How virtual swimming happens is that equal to the swimming speed, they make the water flow in the opposite side. So even if tuna is swimming for its own experience, it stays at the same place, and that can help researchers get it connected with different kind of sensors, because it stays within the tank, and sensors will keep on recording cardiovascular response and other traits. So they can also do another thing with that, that they can decide or control what is the level of dissolved oxygen in the water that they are releasing for tuna. So in that, when you have the different levels of dissolved oxygen, one is normal, that is called normoxic, and then you start pushing that level down to hypoxic levels, and then you can notice the response. So what is the cardiovascular response, how mouth gap it is opening or it is narrowing. So those kind of visual as well as sensor based observations you can gather. It shows that tuna shows very good resilience, like other fishes, other tunas. Yellowfin tuna also shows good resilience, but it has a caveat. So longer the tuna is exposed to the low oxygen waters, or if tuna is exposed not even for long but very low oxygen of waters, it requires more time to be in the normoxic, that is normal oxygen level waters, to recover and show this kind of normal activity. So until unless, it means that, what is the implication that? It means that tuna can survive low oxygen waters, but until unless it is absolutely necessary, it would not prefer to, because otherwise then it requires by force to stay in the well ventilated water for long time, where sometimes it might be also getting attacked, and then it has to move to the deeper waters. So if you have this kind of constraint, and if you don't have any other reason, you would not prefer, if you are a tuna, you would not prefer to be in the low oxygen waters voluntarily. So what could be another reason that if you have to be there in the low oxygen water, which we talked about in the Atlantic and Pacific for forage? Now what happens in the Indian Ocean? So you remember those diamonds that I mentioned, yellow and orange, in the Northern Indian Ocean map? Those were the tracks of the, or the trajectories of the BioArgo. BioArgo are the Argo floats with the chlorophyll sensor on that. And you can see those observations those Argo floats have collected, and you can see the deep chlorophyll maxima that is situated in both the places. It is about 80 meters on an average. Why we need to think about, or what it means to see about the deep chlorophyll maxima, since tuna is not a planktivore fish, but the food for tuna, that is forage fish, will also accumulate nearby to the deep chlorophyll maxima, since the plankton are there. So that is where the Northern Indian Ocean tuna, they have different behavior and different habits. Since the food is available at lower depths, and then deeper depths have less food, less oxygen, very less reason to dive deeper very frequently. That is what it means. Now, what all combined information from this set tuna experiment tells us? So earlier our understanding was that above thermocline and association with thermocline, tuna can actually be having habitat anywhere in these pelagic waters or shallow waters. But that is not true, since we see that from the sea level anomaly data, and we can understand that it is not a particular I should say anything above the thermocline kind of open ground for tuna, but it is a virtual tunnel or corridor that also has the side walls, where it will not prefer to go in the core of the eddy, either it is cyclonic or anticyclonic. So this drastically reduces the habitat or niche for the tuna, and that tells us a lot for other oceans also. How? That I will explain. You can see that in this particular picture, Northern Indian Ocean is very unique basin. Unlike Atlantic or Pacific, it is landlocked from the north. Also, because of the monsoon reversal and associated productivity, and then in turn that the sinking of the production, basically it persistently show low oxygen waters in either of the basins that we have studied, and that is something very close to what projections for the future oceans are there. So in a way that what you study in the northern Indian Ocean now will be what you can study in the other oceans in future. So that is the importance for this study, and you can see that that is a kind of a concern as well. So since last 50 years, you can see that how much dissolved oxygen loss that is there in all the basins. So when we talk about climate change, one of the major implications of the warmer waters and more stratified waters is about the dissolved oxygen loss. As you have seen or learned in the biogeochemistry class as well, that it has a kind of a soda water type of a phenomena. Warmer waters tend to retain less gas, and then it starts losing it. So this the way gas releases or gets released or escapes from soda water when it is getting warmer. So that is what it is happening with the other oceans also, and it is not stopping there itself. The projections already show that these oxygen minimum zones in all the oceans will actually expand further, and on the top of that there will be this warming based on the stratification that will also happen. So those combined will further it will shrink the habitat for the tunas in those oceans. So that is the importance of the physiology that we understood or studied under this Set Tuna project, and what is its implications to the stocks in the other oceans. So from the fishery, as a fishery oceanographer point of view, you can understand that when we have this kind of understanding, we can better manage our stocks, we can make better policies, we can understand that the catchability has increased a lot. Like you can see from this particular figure that if the whole stock is cramped into a narrow place, then basically the catchability will increase a lot, and that's how we need to further regulate the stock in a more efficient way. So with this, this particular talk, it was intense, it was short, it was deliberately kept short because it was intense. And now this is the time for question answer. If you have any question, you can ask and I'll take those questions. So I'll switch to the video mode first, and do we get daily updates on tuna fish from the satellite data? So there are different proxies that tell us about where tuna could be, and depends on what kind of application that one is looking for. If it is only for fishing, you have to pinpoint, and then you have to rely on the multiple data sets, and that may not be that accurate, because essentially satellite data will tell you about the habitat. If you are a resource manager or if you are a researcher studying on the impact on habitat, definitely satellite data will tell you a lot. So that is the answer. So daily update in the sense that satellites will give you daily data. Now for what application you want to make use of that data depends on that. You can say that it is not on tuna locations, but definitely you can understand that what is the habitat, suitable habitat for tuna from the satellite data. Bycass such as billfish could have similar behavior to tuna fishes. Yes, so studies have been done on other billfish like marlins also, but I have not covered it as of now in this particular lecture. So not to, you know, put a lot of things in one lecture, but definitely we will cover those in the other advanced level lectures. But yes, studies do exist. So if you are interested, you can search yourself, or you can put a mail what particular questions for billfish that you are looking for. Then I can help you. Then do humpback whale have the same traits as tuna? You cannot compare whales and tunas. So whales have different physiology, totally different families, different evolutionary pathways. So you cannot compare whales and tunas. Their swimming speeds or metabolism, everything is different. So cannot be compared, but I can say as long as the oxygen minimum zones are concerned, yeah, it actually affects more or less to all the large pelagics, that I can say. Tuna have larger gills, how it differ from the normal fish? Larger gills will give you the larger surface area, so that the dissolved oxygen that is in the water, it has more area, surface area, to come into contact with, and gills have the blood capillaries which will then exchange the gases. So exchange of the gas will be more efficient. That is the importance of having larger gills. It is like having, saying that larger lung capacity in case of humans. Similar to that kind of thing, for just a simple understanding, you can have that. Can you address the reason for OMZ? So it was already covered under biogeochemistry class. So if you remember the production, or if you have not attended that class by any reason, the recording is available on our YouTube channel. So you can go through that. So basically the organic matter that goes beyond a certain depth, that is now not well mixed and well ventilated, the breaking up of that organic matter or digestion by bacteria will consume the oxygen, and that will lead to the low oxygen in the deeper waters. But details and about that and relation with the productivity, you can, for that you can refer to the day 2 lecture 1, session 1. That will be more in detail for your understanding. What is the accuracy of tuna probable habitat based alone on SST? So as this experiment shows, that SST might be useful for some of the basins, but for other basins and other oceans, like in Northern Indian Ocean, it may not have much of the impact, since the whole of the basin, for the both the basins of the Northern Indian Ocean, it lies within the tropical region only. So there is no subtropical Northern Indian Ocean, there is no temperate. So at least on those aspects, the sea surface temperature alone may not be very much helpful. Is the life cycle of yellowfin tuna happened in the same region, or there is a migration according to the life stage? Very good question. So in our study, what data that we could collect, those were only for the 6 to 8 months, and we don't know what about the other seasons, that if tuna goes to the other region as an adult migration. Now when it comes to life cycle, like I explained yesterday in the limitation of satellite telemetry, that you cannot use it for studying the juveniles. So in this study, we only studied adults. So we do not know that whether the breeding grounds where they are. It is the study did not have the objective of mapping the breeding grounds or the extent of juvenile dispersions. So that part it is not covered here. And what are the mainly ocean parameters which conditions this life stage? Again, if the life cycle itself is not resolved, there is a little logic in commenting on the relevant ocean conditions. But we hope in future those also will be more better resolved. Now, understanding that Northern Indian Ocean has different traits, oceanographic traits, we can assume that whole life cycle also might be different than in compared to the other oceans. Mythical objects like mermaid, this is not part of this particular topic. What is the reason behind the low dissolved oxygen level in the Arabian Sea? So there are n number of papers that beautifully explains the extent and the mechanisms of and dynamics of the oxygen minimum zone in the Arabian Sea. So I would not be able to cover here only in the question and answer, but I would again suggest to refer you to this biogeochemistry lecture, or if you can go through this tuna study that we published. We have quoted those papers, especially Naqvi et al. They have published very groundbreaking papers that explains the mapping and extent, seasonal and spatial extents of the oxygen minimum zone in the Arabian Sea. Is it important to consider MLD when predicting tuna? So yes, definitely. So mixed layer depth basically tells you about the waters above that are well ventilated. Waters or water column below that is not that good ventilated. So when we wanted to explain in terms of oxycline depth here, MLD also, because in case of Arabian Sea and Bay of Bengal, it actually corresponds similar to the oxycline depth. So we can say that MLD is also one of the important criteria, because basically it tells you that the waters are ventilated enough or not. But only MLD, the mixed layer depth, if it is shallow, then it tells you that there is a habitat is shrunken for tuna in that region. And if it is otherwise, then tuna has more room to move freely in the well-ventilated waters. So that is the importance of mixed layer depth with reference to tuna. Does the behavior changing swimming layer of tuna also applicable for other species of tuna? Definitely. And yellowfin tuna also differ in many traits than bluefin tuna or big eye tuna. So with reference to that, but we have studied only yellowfin tuna, so I have covered that part. And if you are interested, and you can give in the feedback these things also, what topics would be more of your interest that we can cover in the next levels of this course that we conduct in future. So I think that is the end of the questions. Yeah, that was the last question that I saw.
The behaviors?
Yeah. That was the last question I saw.
Yeah.
So after that, I think there is no question, right? Alright, so with that, this was my last lecture. And two more lectures are there by my colleagues tomorrow. So you can attend those, and you can then... another important notification. That many of you have been asking about the test. So we will be providing you a test in terms of a quiz, online quiz, and that will be made available, I think, tomorrow. Yeah, in a form of a Google form. So all the registered participants will get the link. And in Google form, you have to enter your registration number also, unique registration number. So those submissions that is coming from registered users only will be considered. And out of those registered participants also, those who submit the test successfully only will be considered for the e-certificate. So you can always learn going through these videos whether you are a registered participant or not. But if you are willing to have the e-certificate, these are the prerequisites. So The Google form link will be, I think, open for a few days. Yeah, so at least 2 days it will be there. So at that time also, after receiving the link and when you go through the questions, we don't mind that before attempting the answer, you can go through the videos. And we very much welcome that, because that is the idea. We want to encourage you to go through these videos and learn new. So after going through the video, you attempt the test. That is also fine. It is more like open book exam. But the idea is that you learn something out of these 10 lectures. So now you know that the test link will be provided to you, and then you can attempt that. So do go through very rigorously these 8 lectures that has been delivered so far, and 2 more lectures that will be delivered tomorrow. See you in the next level of the course.